If you're interested in living systems, it should be immediately obvious from this graph why it is that you focus so much effort studying organic chemistry, the chemistry of carbon-based compounds. The one thing that jumps out from this graph is that living matter has a significant composition of carbon-based material, whereas non-living matter is almost void completely of carbon. So with all of the fundamental studies that we have acquired in our pursuit of organic chemistry, it's time to start putting that knowledge to use and begin to apply that to the building blocks of life, which is where the rest of the semester is going to take us. We're going to study the amino acids, the nucleic acids, and the carbohydrates, the three basic building blocks of life, starting with the amino acids. The amino acids are the building blocks that make up proteins. Proteins are polymer chains. That means they're made of many parts. The parts are the L-alpha amino acids. And so proteins are really just polyamino acids linked together by an amide functional group. And in a protein, that linkage is known as the peptide bond. We refer to it as the peptide or the amide linkage. All the amino acids have a stereogenic center, a chirality center, and all of the natural, or I should say most of the natural amino acids, have the L configuration. That's the stereochemistry that is shown here. And the L configuration, we can remind ourselves of what it is by making a mental image of this picture where we put the amino group on the left, the carboxylic acid on the right, and the alpha carbon, which is the carbon that is adjacent to the carbonyl of the carboxylic acid, pointed upward. So with the three atoms in the plane drawn with the wedge pointing upward like that, then the L configuration is where that R group, which is where the variability from in the amino acids comes about, when that R group is pointed toward us with the orientation just as I described, then we are dealing with the L configuration. The D configuration has that group going backwards, and while there are a few D amino acids found in nature, they're much, much less common. The basic linkage of amino acids together into a string of peptides, polypeptides, is what's known as the primary protein structure. And on the next slide, I'll show you what a typical linkage of alpha amino acids looks like. Here's five amino acids linked together. And basically, what we're always going to do is to think about the backbone as having directionality associated with it. That directionality is going to be defined from the N-terminus to the alpha carbon to the carbonyl. So if I were to just take any spot in a peptide chain, identify the alpha carbon at that position, I can see that there is a directionality of N to carbon alpha to carbonyl just like that. And we call that the N to C direction. And so there's an N terminus on a peptide chain, and somewhere over here at the other end, there's going to be a carboxylic acid terminus, and this has to be the case given the structure of the L-alpha amino acids. Amino and carboxylic acid groups in each building block is propagated all along the chain to from one end to the other. If we just look at what this particular sequence of five amino acids is like, we can either represent the 20 amino acids by three-letter codes. We'll get into this in more detail in the next webcast. Or we could represent them as single letters. And so metalfeserasp is the peptide backbone in which the peptide chain is linked together from the first amino acid group, starting with the N-terminus, which is methionine, has that structure there, followed by alanine. And I'll stop right here because notice that I asked you to make a mental picture of that B-shaped structure where the amino group is on the left and the carboxylic acid is on the right. If I position that upside down like that, and that's exactly the natural way to draw the peptide chain as it goes through the linkage into the second alpha position, alpha carbon position. When I take that and flip it upside down, notice that the configuration is naturally going to be now drawn in the plane of the screen. So the second group goes back. The third group, which is the phenylalanine, that's going to come out towards us. And then the next group, the serine hydroxyl group, that goes back. And finally, the aspartate group comes out towards us. I've drawn these amino acids in their ionized form under physiological pH. the carboxylic acid is dissociated, the amino group has picked up a proton on the N-terminus. There are some pretty deep-rooted questions that we could ask here, and I won't spend a lot of time on this, but it's at this point where you can really start to pause and wonder why nature chose the 20 amino acids that it did and not something else. And that's really the gist of this question. And this is worth reading because basically I think we tend to just accept and take for granted the structures of these 20 amino acids which we're typically asked to memorize. But in fact, if you really stop and ask some deep-rooted questions, you can intrigue yourself with why these are the structures that nature has chosen to make as its primary building block. Why weren't they hydroxy acids? Why weren't they beta or gamma or delta? And so look at these structures. There's the alpha. There's the alpha position. There's the beta position. There's the gamma position. There's the delta position. Why weren't the distance between the amino group and the carboxylic acid group longer? And that has to do a lot with the flexibility and rigidity of the backbone that we'll talk about in a couple of webcasts. Why only 20 amino acids, and why do they all have at least one alpha hydrogen? Is the alpha hydrogen play a role in the chemistry? We can begin to think about questions like that. How come the nitrogen group, except in the case of proline, wasn't alkylated? It wasn't going to have an alkyl group attached to it. Instead, it always is going to have at least a hydrogen atom there. Why are typically the amino acids used, and on what basis were those side chains that we're going to learn about in the next webcast selected? And then, of course, the question about how come this alphabet of 20 is enough when, especially given the genetic code that we'll learn about, has the can accommodate a much larger alphabet.